getting ready to hit what? You turn it on the phone? Where's your phone? You're not turning on the phone?
Good morning, good morning, good morning. To God be the glory. On this third Sunday in February, we praise God for just allowing us to be in his presence. We praise him for allowing us to see another day, for he is wonderful. He's wonderful, he's gracious, he's loving, he's kind. He is an awesome God. He is an awesome God. And just to let you know and remind you that this Sunday is the last Sunday that we will be here in February, and the fourth Sunday we have no service. We have no service at fourth Sunday. I'm amazed at how many times people text me and wonder why we're not having service on today, or I was looking for you and I didn't find you today. We don't have service on fourth Sunday. Amen. But on fourth Saturday, amen, which is the 25th of this month, we will be having Neighbors to Neighbors. Neighbors to Neighbors. So I encourage you to go to our website. Amen. If there's anyone that you want us to see or to visit or to bring some food or a bag of food to, go to our website, put in the information. Amen. Amen. I do check the website. Jackson checks the website, and I want to give him a shout out for doing such a good job in keeping our website and Facebook page up, letting you know what's coming up and everything. He's doing a really good job. So to God be the glory. Let's give him a hand clap for doing that. That's little Jackson. Well, he's not little Jackson, but that's Jackson the third. Amen. 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 To God be the glory. As we stand all over. And we're doing hymn number 504. And I have on the program now the verses that we're going to be doing. Amen. Verses 1, 4, and 5. Trust and obey. Trust and obey.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory the sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still. And with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but trust and obey. But we never can prove the delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows, for the joy he bestows, are for them who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other
to trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we will sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he says we will do, where he sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Amen. Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Trust and obey, for there's no other way. No other way. We think we found other ways to do what we need to do, but to be happy in Jesus, we have to trust. We need to trust and obey. And the only way you can do that is to have a relationship with him so you can reap the benefits of what he has for you. Amen. Amen. To God be the glory. And now we'll have our prayer by Brother Jackson Jordan, our scripture by Brother Willard Garrett, our Daily Bread by Sister Crystal Galloway, and our Black History Moment by Brother Rashard Galloway. And then our announcements by Brother Jackson Jordan III.
Amen. Good morning. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as in heaven. Lord, we thank you, Lord, just for waking us up this morning and starting us out a new day.
Yes.
And Lord, we try to learn to trust and obey, and sometimes we don't do it, so we thank you, Lord, for loving us anyway.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, for looking out for us. We thank you, Lord, for blessing all of our, all the churches, all the members that are present here, and for all those that are listening over the airwaves.
Yes.
We thank you, Lord, for still continuing to look out for our country. We ask you, Lord, to bless all of those that are suffering, all of the ones that are in nursing homes, the bereaved, the homeless. Protect us, Lord, continue to protect us and cover everybody from all of the gun violence. Seems like it's every day now. Lord, we still ask you to look out for us for that. Ask you, Lord, to continue to bless our military, all of our soldiers, all of our policemen, all of our essential workers. We ask you, Lord, just to continue to bless all of us. Lord, we continue to ask you too to just look out for our children.
Yes.
Continue to look out for them. This is my prayer this morning, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
The scripture is coming from Colossians 3:17-20. And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Wives, submit to your husbands as it's fitting for those who belong to the Lord. Husband, love your wives and never treat them harshly.
All right.
Children, always obey your parents, for this pleases the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
If my people will humble themselves, then I will hear from heaven. 2 Chronicles 7:14. Revival comes. Aroykin is a small town in northern Australia. Its Aboriginal population drawn from 7 clans. While the gospel came to Aroykin a century ago, eye for eye retribution sometimes remained. In 2015, Klan tensions grew, and when a murder happened, payback required someone from the offender's family to die in return. But something remarkable happened in early 2016. The people of Oroykin started seeking God in prayer. Repentance followed then, mass baptisms, as revival began sweeping the town. People were so joyful, they danced in the streets, and instead of enacting payback, the family of the murdered man forgave the offending Klan. Soon, 1,000 people were in church each Sunday in a town of just 1,300. We see revivals like this in Scripture, as in Hezekiah's day when crowds joyfully returned to God, and on the day of Pentecost when thousands repented. While revival is God's work done in His time, history shows prayer precedes it. If my people will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, God told Solomon, I will forgive their sin and will heal their land. As the people of Oroykin found revival brings joy and reconciliation to a town, how our own cities need such transformation. Father, bring revival to us too. While there's no formula for revival, what do you think helps lead to it? How can you respond to God today to help revival come? Dear Father, please bring revival to our land, starting with me. Amen.
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 Good morning. Audrea Lord. Audrea Lord was a laud writer and poet known for her radical honesty and fight against racism and sexism. Self-described as a black lesbian mother warrior poet, Lord wrote often about the intersections of identities. After earning both a PA from Hunter College and master's from Columbia University, Lord spent the 1960s working as a librarian in New York. In 1970, she wrote as a poet in residence of Tougaloo College in Mississippi and began publishing poetry collection. The works were informed by the intersections of race, class, and gender, and became increasingly more political. Some of her famous works are The Master's Tools Won't Dismantle the Master's House, and Martha. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
The announcements are as follows. Morning worship service is each first, second, third, and fifth Sundays at 9 a.m. Bible study is each Tuesday at the pastor's home address, and you can join us via Facebook or the conference line. Neighbors Helping Neighbors is this Saturday at noon here at the community center. Our sick and shut-in list is Trinity Bolden, Nora Crawford, Rhonda Risbon, Carol Lewis, Pastor Ron Davis, Laurette Corbin, Lucille Merle and family, Ida Foy and family, Reverend Betty Newkirk, and Charles Newkirk. And our prison ministry adoptees are Randy Brown and Taekwon Millett.
Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. I want to give a shout out to those who gave on last week. Amen. Sister Celeste Whitted, Sister Veronica Falk, Reverend Betty Newkirk, and Leon and Peggy Grady, better known as Ira and Constance. Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. On next month is March, and we will be celebrating as well our women. It's Women's History Month. Amen. Amen. And even though I won't be here for the first two services, is there a fifth Sunday in March? Who got a calendar? Is there a fifth Sunday in March? No. No fifth Sunday in March. Amen. Then I'll be preaching only one Sunday in March. Amen. Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. But we're asking that everybody still join for service, because service will continue first and second Sunday. Amen. We'll be here first Sunday, part of the Sunday, and service will be here on second Sunday. Amen. The church doors will be still open, and there will be someone to bring a word from the Lord. Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. I told the people here that we got to learn that even though we're not here, that church service still need to go on unless we're somewhere that we can do it wherever we are. Amen. Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. God is good, and he's good all the time.
Yes, he is.
And I sure thank him for his faithfulness. His faithfulness to us. His faithfulness. Amen. Amen. Because as Brother Jordan said, we don't want to trust and obey all the time.
That's true.
But sometimes we got to.
That's right.
And when you don't trust and obey, then you need to ask for forgiveness. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. As we prepare now for our altar of prayer, amen, as we prepare for it, thanking God for his grace and his mercy, thanking God for just allowing us to be in his presence, praying for everything that you have that you need to talk to the Lord about. Intercessory prayer, that's what we do for each other, but you need to go on your knees and ask God what you need, what you desire. He said, bring your supplications and everything, whatever your requests, let them be made known to him so that he will hear your needs. To God be the glory. Don't wait on somebody else to pray for you. Don't wait on somebody else to pray for you. But in the meantime, always pray for somebody else in your prayers. Amen. Because he told us to pray ye one for another. To God be the glory. Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come before you this morning, thanking you, God, again for all that you have done. And Lord, as we pray, as we come to you individually but collectively and corporately, we ask, O Heavenly Father, that you hear our prayers, hear our cries. Heavenly Father, we know that we're living in the last days, and we know that you're going to come back. And we know that everything that has happened, if Satan was in heaven messing up and you had to put him out, we know that here on earth, things are not going to get straight till you come back. So, Lord, we ask that you keep us humble. Help us to continue to pray and lift others up in prayer. Not just with what we're going through, but everybody else, oh, Heavenly Father. God, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you for our present situation. We thank you, Lord, for what you've already done. We thank you, Lord, for what you have already done before we even see it. We thank you, God. We thank you. Because God, you're awesome. You are awesome. You hear all. You see all. You know all. God, only you can give us the right direction into where we need to go. So God, we thank you. Continue to bless, Lord. We're praying for traveling mercies for everybody on the highways and byways, up in the air. Lord, we pray on the tracks.
the train, we're praying, God, buses, cars, we're praying, God, for traveling verses, oh Heavenly Father. And Lord, just like you reign on the just as well as the unjust, on the unjust as well as the just, we're asking God for our prayer to be for all those who do not know you. In the pardon of their sins, that they come to know you. That they come to know you and your goodness and your mercy. We thank you, God. We thank you. This is our prayer, Lord, we pray. In the precious name of Jesus Christ. And everybody say, amen. Amen. To God be the glory. Of the Lord. Amen. Amen. The goodness of the Lord. Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. And now, the song that I picked for the song of inspiration, I had never heard this song by Marvin Gaye. I had never heard it. So this song is old and it's on his album. Believe it or not, the name of the album was God is Love. Amen. And I listened to that. Someone sent it to me. Amen. Michelle sent it to me out of Maryland. She sent it to me. And I'm like, wow, I didn't even know. And I thought I heard everything that Marvin Gaye made. Amen. 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 He was a good singer, killed by his father. Amen. But when you hear this song, it kind of reminds you of what's going on. But anyway. Amen.
Don't go and say things about my father. He loves.
the first Sunday in February. Michaela had on a shirt that said love. And I didn't see the shirt till service was over. Amen. And I know your mama and your grandmama don't want you to be wearing clothes the same as. But I asked her to let you wear that shirt today. Or when you came back, I sure did. I said, put that shirt on her. But she don't have it on. But when I looked at her, I said, Lord, she got on her Black History pants. Amen. Her Black History outfit. Ain't this something? I'm going to do it like this here. And she all trimmed and gold. Amen. To God be the glory. I was looking over there. I said, oh my God, she got on her Black History pants. That ain't what I really said. I said, she like Pocahontas today. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God, and the children will lead us one day. Amen. As we bow our heads for a word of prayer, to God be the glory. Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We give you glory. For Lord, you are love. You are love. And I know, God, we celebrate February as being the month of love. It's the Black History Month. But God, you're love. And every day that we have our move, our being in you, everything needs to be celebrated when it comes to you.
Yes.
When it comes to you, every day. Your thanksgiving, your faithfulness needs to be celebrated every day. So, Lord, as I come to bring the word, I just ask you, Heavenly Father, to touch my heart. Touch the heart of those who listen. And Lord, as I always ask, will the real preacher come?
Yes.
In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. I'm coming from today, Ephesians 5th chapter, verses 1 through 2 and 21 through 33. Follow God's example. Therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrance offering and sacrifice to God. And then 21 through 33. Follow God's submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands, as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated their own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. However, each one of you also must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Many times, we hear everyone talk about submission, the wife submitting to the husband. We're always hearing that. But for a few brief moments, I want to talk about love me as you love the Lord. Love me as you love the Lord. When he was talking about being submissive, when Paul was talking to Ephesians, to Ephesus, and not just to Ephesus, but this scripture, as Gary read, he also told Colossians to do the same thing.
So that meant, and that said to me, that the Church of Colossae, the Church of Ephesus, he didn't put together the Church of Colossae, that was Epaphras. In Ephesus, he did visit Ephesus at one time and establish some church there in his missionary journeys. But in prison is when he wrote back because of the news he was hearing from the churches. The churches was being overrun now by false teachers because Paul's absence was not there. He wasn't there. And they figured, I can get people to do whatever now that we need to do. That's just like it is today. You get a good preacher in a church, and when something happens that they leave or they die or they go somewhere else, everybody now is stalking the church, trying to get in there so that they can get a paycheck. Lord, I hate to say it, but that's what it's about with some of them. They can get a paycheck and know that that's their second job. Amen. Because they're already budgeting their families off of their work salaries and whatever they're going to get from a church. So they want to make sure that they can get in there and do that. Truth be told, that's what a lot of them do. Not all of them now. Not all of them. Because some was called by God into that vineyard to labor. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we started this month by talking about God's love, how we should love each other because he loved us first. And today we're going to talk about love with God, with the husband and the wife. Usually with that kind of love, it's not more or less agape. We're talking about eros, the erotic love, the physical love between male and female. Paul started chapter 5 with the people of Ephesus to follow God's example. As dearly loved children of God, we are to walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. If you have not read chapter 5, you need to do so, because he tells us what not to do and what is sinful. And I am astonished sometimes how people can tell you what a sin is and don't even mention the sins in the Bible. But they can tell you what a sin is, but they're not doing what they need to do, but they're going to tell you what sin is. And some people create sins because you won't find them in the Bible, but it's just how they feel about sin. But you know, God has already named the things that will not allow you to inherit the kingdom of heaven. Read Ephesians chapter 5. He tells you. And then he tells us that anything that you do that you don't feel comfortable with, that you don't feel pleases him, then you stop doing it. If you feeling uncomfortable about it and you feel it doesn't give him glory, then you need to stop. But because it doesn't do that for you, you ain't got no business out there telling everybody else that it's a sin. And it may not be a sin for everybody else. So we need to look at what we do when we tell people what sins are, and know that sin is anything that separates you from God. That's what sin is. It separates you from him and his love. How we make up excuses, we try to justify the sins in the Bible, but we don't want to heed them. But from the third verse to verse 21, he explains what we should not do, and he explains it very vividly. And then he tells us what to do when we come into the kingdom of God through Jesus, and how to walk in the light, to reverence him, so that those who are still in darkness would want to join you. Then he uses the married couple as the analogy, because Jesus is the groom and the church is the bride. He starts by telling us to not be drunk with wine in excess. Not be drunk with wine in excess. Didn't tell you you couldn't drink it.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
And we lie when we tell people it is a sin to drink it.
That's right. That's right.
It's a sin to overdo it.
Yes. Yes.
It's a sin to drink it when you're drinking it to cause you to be strong and powerful and say things that you wouldn't normally say. So let's be clear on that, what he says. But then he says, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, making melodies in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. He wants us to be sober-minded. When we coming to him, he wants us to know what we're saying when we're talking to him. When we're talking to him. And then he says, submit yourselves one to another in the fear of God. Then he tells the wives to submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. The husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and Jesus is the Savior of the body. The husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the church. And he ends talking about this by saying, he is talking about Christ and the church. But he also says that when you're married, whether you're in Christ or not, it should be a respect between the person that you married and yourself. There should be a respect there. You should want to be doing things together. You should want to love each other. You should want to laugh and have a good time together. You should want to do this. But then he letting us know that as females, we need to know our place. We need to know our place. I'm the pastor of the church. JJ is my husband, but don't think I don't do what he tells me to do. Because he is the head of the house. He is the head of the house, and I do what he say. Sometimes he don't realize I am doing what he say. I may not act like I'm doing what he say, but I do what he say, because I know that what I do, I have to do it as unto the Lord.
Amen.
If I don't do it as unto the Lord, I may as well not do it anyway. I may as well not do it anyway. Now, we want to think that, yes, that means if he is a Christian man and she is a Christian woman. And that means that Christ is saying only if you are evenly yoked. Well, then, that means anyone who wants to marry and don't know Christ should just go somewhere else to be married and not at the physical church. So Christians should be able to attend and not feel guilty for supporting people who are not in the household of faith. Everybody to get married ain't going to be evenly yoked.
Amen.
Some of them may be because they're sitting in church and you got a lot of women that go to church looking for a husband. You got a lot of men going to church looking for a wife. You got them doing that. But it doesn't say that what they get out of church is still what they should have. I'm just saying. Then you got women and men that are both. They get married while they're out there doing things and having a good time and satisfying each other. And when one decides that they want to submit and give their life to the Lord, there starts a turmoil in the house. Because now I'm saved and you're not saved. So now what do I do? What do I do? If you come in there and you're drinking, I'm going to pour your stuff down the drain. Leave the man liquor alone. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. Because he ain't necessarily ready to do So what you should do is move in the way that he should want what you have received already. You need to walk in a way that he will look at you and says, no matter what goes on, you still have a joy that I'm trying to find. Where is it coming from? Mm-hmm. You know, we're constantly fighting. Then she can say, no, you constantly fighting. And because you fighting, you think I'm fighting. I ain't fighting. I just go on and ignore you. But when you live your life in front of them so that they can see, and then he can take his rightful place where he's supposed to be as the head of the wife, and both of you doing what you need to do for Christ.
Yes.
You got to respect each other. You got to respect each other. What is the man's job in the house? He's to make sure you eat. He's to make sure you got a roof over your head.
Yes.
Believe it or not, he's to make sure that you cool in the summer and warm in the winter.
All right, now.
That's the job.
Yes.
That's his job. That's the job. He's to make sure that you're able to get the things that you need and some of the things that you want.
Yes.
Not everything that you want. Because in that way, he's treating you just like God treats us.
Yes.
God don't give us everything we want, but he sure supplies our needs.
Yes, he does.
He takes care of us, whether we realize it or not.
Mm-hmm.
He does. And wives, you shouldn't be bullying your husbands. What do you mean, bullying my husband? Making them not feel worthy. Making them feel like you got the best thing that you ever had, and you better treat it like that.
All right.
You married him, and you should have explained all these things before you got married to him. You should have told him, I'm the best thing that you ever had. So if that ain't what you want, you best go on about your business. And if he choose not to go, then that means he agree with you. You are the best thing that I've ever had. But you don't bully him in the relationship. You can't make him feel worthless and that you're better than he is. Because if so, you should have stayed by yourself again. Your love for him should be as your love for the Lord when you come into the body of Christ, if you're not evenly yoked. And trust me, the same thing for the man. If you come into the body of Christ after you're married, you don't treat her any kind of way, because she's still your wife.
Yes.
She's still your queen. So you should be treating her just as Christ treats the church.
Amen.
How are you able to say you love God whom you have never seen, and you don't love your husband or you don't love your wife? And then there's another question. Can you fall out of love with your spouse?
Oh, Lord Jesus.
The question is, do you want to fall out of love with your spouse? Even if there is abuse, you still have to love. You don't have to stay there in the abuse, whether physical or mental, but you still need to love. And you need to learn how to forgive.
Mm-hmm.
I'm talking about the husband because there are some cruel females in this world. There are some mean women. There are some mean women. I'm going to talk about one of them next month, and that's Jezebel. We're going to talk about Jezebel next month. We're going to talk about her. If you thought you were a good person when he married you, then continue to be the good person.
Mm-hmm.
But if you didn't have Jesus, then all that good is in vain anyway. But there is a principle that you should be going by whether you have Jesus or not, and that is respecting the man that you married and treating him like he is somebody and treating him like you want to be treated. Yes, love your neighbor like you love yourself. Now, husbands, you don't get off that easy either, because the law was given to man in the Garden of Eden. Your responsibility, as I said before, is to provide for your wife and your family. Let her know when things are bad so that you can have her support. Let her know when you need her to help make a decision and stand firm on a decision you made together, not blaming her if things go wrong, but believing and standing on the word of God that he will bring you both through. That is what it means to love as unto the Lord. Making sure that you are not putting her or yourself above God, but making sure that what you do, the both of you, is pleasing God.
Yes.
Just as Jesus takes care of the church, you should be taking care of your wife. What happens if she doesn't obey me? Did you ask her to do something, or did you command her to do something? Is what you ask her to do, is what God would ask you to do? Because all of his commandments are in his word.
Yes.
Jesus gave the commandment and said it was new, and that is to love one another.
Yes.
So that people would know you were his disciple. Why do we have people that feel that living together and playing or pretending to be a family is the same as making a commitment to honor one another and respect one another? Yes, people break those vows, but they are breaking the commandments of God every day.
Mm-hmm.
You worried about the vows that you take as a man and a woman? Look at the Ten Commandments every day. Every day you're breaking them. Every day you're not doing what somebody said, like JJ said. Lord, we don't trust and obey all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But then we need to be saying, God, forgive me.
Yes.
God, forgive me. Sin is sin. And you can't make any excuses for one sin being better than the other. They all will keep you out of heaven. And if not, then God's word is not true. He will be returning for the bride, which is his church, without spot or wrinkle. He takes care of his bride by loving her, caring for her, and letting her know he will not leave or forsake her. Sometimes the chemistry of two people doesn't seem to work well together. They find out they work better without commitment. Well, all I can say to that is, love the Lord with all your heart, lean not to your understanding, and in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Because no matter what you tell a person on what to do, people are going to do what they want to do until they're faced with their own crisis. Paul had to address this in the church of Colossae as well as the Ephesians. So that means that not only was there something wrong in the church, but families was going through. If everyone would look at their marriage as Christ being their groom, and they both, the husband and the wife, is the bride, then Paul is saying you should be able to correct that which is wrong and continue to move forward to build the kingdom of heaven. No marriage is perfect, and it doesn't mean wrong will not be done or that there will not be any problems, but you do learn that if God is not first, there will be more problems than necessary.
Yes.
And you also learn that you may go to him individually in prayer, but you are asking for the same thing, and that is to bring you both back on one accord. So those who are married and listening today, yes, there is more to be said, but will you remember this? Read 1 Corinthians 13th chapter and know that the more excellent way to do everything in your life is through love. Know that God is love, and Jesus wants to be your Savior so that you can call God your friend,
mm-hmm,
as well as your Father.
Yes.
That's what Marvin Gaye said. He wants to call God his friend.
Yes.
1 John 4th chapter 8th through the 9th verse says, whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. So Lionel Richie wrote the song for the Commodores in 1980 that is still on the R&B charts as well as the gospel charts. And that song is Jesus is Love. And I'm just going to do just a little bit. He says, Father, help your children and don't let them fall by the side of the road. Teach them to love one another that heaven might find a place in their hearts. Why? Because Jesus is love. He won't let you down, and you know that he's yours forever in your heart. You're going to walk. You're going to walk through temptation because his love and his wisdom will be our helping hand. And I know the truth, and his words will be our salvation. Lift up our hearts to be thankful and glad because Jesus, what is it, Mary? He's love. He's love. And he won't let you down. As we stand all over the church, thanking God for who he is, thanking God for just being God all by himself, thanking God for the creation, and thanking him for all those who have come to him. So we open up the doors of the church to you right now, wherever you are. All you got to do is ask Christ to come into your life. Repent of your sins. Ask him to forgive you. And he says that once he does, he will remember them no more. Everything that you've done in the past is over. It's done. He's forgiven you. You got a new slate. You can start new. Once you have done that and accepted him and understand that he died for you so that you could have life, when you believe that, not make it a belief, but when you believe it, get yourself in a church somewhere. And whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord. Don't worry about the other people in the church. Don't worry about what they're doing in the church. But do it as unto the Lord. And understand this. Going to church doesn't mean you're serving God. Go to church to worship him. Serving him is outside of those four walls. With the people that you meet, with the people that you see, with those that he put in your heart to go and minister to. That's serving the Lord. That's saying it's not about me, but it's all about you. That's saying that you want somebody else to have the joy of the Lord that you have. That's what it's saying. Lord, we thank you and we praise you. We give you glory. For God, you are worthy. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for those who don't know you, that they come to know you, Heavenly Father, because Jesus, your love. Your love. And you don't let nobody down. We may let ourselves down, but you don't let nobody down. God, we thank you. We thank you. And now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding rest, rule, and abide with each and every one of us as we leave this place, but Lord, not your presence. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody say, amen. Amen. Miss Kizzy. Miss Kizzy.